are in what are the main aspects of your body, because we are managing that. Thanks for the best introductions.
Professors, dear colleagues, the topic I chose to address today refers to one of the typical issues arising in a multi-party context. Statistics show that over 40% of arbitration cases nowadays involve more than two parties. The matter is of significant practical relevance not only from a case management perspective, but also because an arbitral award issued by a properly constituted tribunal may be set aside at the place of the arbitration proceedings or if used enforcement at the place of enforcement. Typically, in disputes involving multiple parties, courts of mind institutions alike are faced with the following questions. Does each party enjoy a personal right to appoint its own arbitrator? Can a party waive its right to appoint an arbitrator by agreeing to arbitrate under the rules of a certain institution? Can multiple parties on one side be held to jointly appoint an arbitrator, and what happens if they fail to do so? Basically, the question is how to balance parties' equality while ensuring procedural efficiency in the appointment process. I'd like to stress at the very beginning that an arbitrator's duty to be impartial and independent does not necessarily dissipate the concerns related to parties' equality, since appointing an arbitrator is not only an act of confidence in the arbitrator's independence and impartiality, but also an act of confidence in the arbitrator's knowledge, legal and technical expertise, and eventually suitability to deal with a certain case. Various mechanisms exist in order to avoid issues linked to the multi-party nature of the case, such as agreeing that a dispute shall be settled by a sole arbitrator or by a panel of arbitrators but to be appointed unanimously by the parties, or to have recourse to an appointing authority, usually a court of law or an institution. However, quite often, the parties do not anticipate the difficulties they might face at the time of the constitution of the arbitral tribunal, and simply provide in the arbitration agreement that the dispute is to be settled by three arbitrators, one to be nominated by the claimant, one by the respondent, and the third presiding arbitrator by the institution or by the two-party appointing arbitrators. This scenario is closely linked to the widely known Vico decision rendered by the French Court of Arbitration in 1992, which, as we shall see, is in fact the reason behind the ruling of the provisions on appointment of arbitrators inserted in all major institutional arbitration rules. So, briefly, the facts in the Vico case were as follows. The claimee, as general contractor, entered into an agreement with Vico as the construction company and with Siemens as the engineering company. On the grounds of the ICC arbitration clause, Vico commenced arbitration proceedings against Decaini and Siemens, and the ICC court, in accordance with its previous practice, requested the respondents to appoint an arbitrator jointly, and informed them that if they failed to do so, then the institution would appoint that arbitrator for them, which implied maintaining the nomination already made by the claimant. The respondents finally appointed an arbitrator jointly, but also under protest, and after the issuance of the arbitral award, they challenged it before the French courts of law. On this occasion, the French Court of Cassation held that obliging multiple respondents to appoint an arbitrator jointly infringed parties' equality. And the court went even further by stating that this was a principle of public policy and that each party's right to appoint an arbitrator was not subject, could not be caused numerous arbitral institutions to revise their rules and regulate specific mechanisms to be used in multi-party disputes for the appointment of arbitrators. Under slightly different wordings, the provisions on appointment of arbitrators contain the rule according to which if the party on one side failed to jointly appoint an arbitrator, then that arbitrator shall be appointed, then all the arbitrators shall be appointed by the institution. The arbitration rules differ, however, as to whether the institution has the discretion to appoint all the members of the arbitral panel or an obligation to do so. And there are two main approaches in the arbitration rules. On the one hand, the approach of the Stockholm rules and of the German rules, which provide that the institution, in this case, has the obligation to appoint all the members of the arbitral panel and disregard the nomination made by the claimant, while the ICC rules becomes of relevance. Thus, firstly, if multiple parties on one side unite interests, and if the multiple parties in the proceedings can be divided into two separate camps, namely the claimants and the respondents camp, then we are in what is commonly referred to as a bipolar arbitration. Examples of bipolar arbitration include claims of a third party against members of the same consortium or joint venture or other type of partnership. The solution to be applied in this case, and records show that the ICC does take account of this distinction, is to maintain the appointment already made by the claimant and appoint only the arbitrator for the defaulting side and the presiding arbitrator. On the other hand, if the interests of multiple parties in the proceedings are distinct or divergent, then we are in a multipolar setup. This was in fact the case in the Ditko decision. So Ditko filed distinct claims against Mekhaimi and Siemens respectively, and the factual circumstances it alleged again in support of those claims were different as well. So he could very well have brought separate arbitration proceedings against the two respondents. And although the French Court of Cassation does not state it expressly, legal doctrine suggests that if the interests of the respondents in the Ditko case had been aligned, then the solution would have presumably differed. A specific set of rules, the NCIA rules, contain a somewhat original approach by acknowledging the distinction which has to be made between bipolar and multipolar arbitration, and by setting up a presumption that disputing with the multiple parties is automatically to be considered as a multipolar dispute. And in order for the parties to overturn this presumption, they must agree in writing that they represent two different sides. If they do not do that, then the institution shall intervene and appoint all members of the arbitral panel. But by way of contrast to all the rules addressed before, the LCIA shall intervene automatically and shall not have to wait the parties to attempt the joint nomination and fail. So to conclude, what all the rules addressed have in common is that they seem to acknowledge that the French Court of Cassation might have gone too far by holding that a party cannot waive its right to